Welcome to another episode of the AI Show. Today we're going to be talking about the intelligent edge with Anuswa Trivedi. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Awesome. Tell us a little bit about the project.
So today we are going to talk about real-time edge AI. It's important nowadays to not only work on AI applications, but work in a way to actually give it access to every user and empower every developer. So what we're trying to do here is show you how we build a model on Azure and how can we actually deploy it on the edge device itself.
I see. So this is machine learning, but instead of putting the models in the cloud, it actually works on the devices that you're looking at.
That's exactly correct, yes.
Awesome. Tell us about the project. There's got to be a use case that you have.
Yes. So when we were thinking about AI applications, the first thing which struck us was healthcare. So it has a profound effect on everyone's life. And what if we can develop an AI product which affects healthcare? So we were thinking about the example of skin cancer. What if we can actually develop an app which will enable us to, put us in a priority queue? So take the example of third world countries. I come from India, to take the example of my country. There is the patient and the doctor ratio is like super weird there. For one doctor, you have thousands and thousands of patients. So how can the doctors prioritize the use cases which are super essential? And cancer is very, very time sensitive, as you know. So we thought about, okay, what if we can actually create a suggestion app, kind of an AI assistant for the users, or even can be used by the doctors, which will be able to, detect the stages of skin cancer and suggest if you need to go and see a doctor.
I see, so it's not a doctor. We don't want people to be confused about. No. We don't want people to be confused about whether this is.
It's just a prediction app, as AI does. Yeah. So AI does predictions for you, and here it tries to confidently say if you need to go see a doctor or not.
Awesome. So tell us a little bit about how you went from idea to actual model, or maybe we should start with a demo just so people can see what it is. What would you like to do first?
Let's start with a demo first.
Okay.
As you see here, I have on my screen, I have two apps. I have a photo version of the app, and I have a video version of the app.
Okay.
Let me just first start with the photo version. What I have done here, I've already preloaded this app with different types of images. Let me choose one of the images and see what it gives me. So as you can see, for this image, it's telling me I'm all clear. So I can still be confident by not going to a doctor. Let me choose another one. Okay, as you can see here, it's suggesting me to, you should surely go see a doctor. Okay, so, but what if we can make this app real time, right? For example, what if we can feed it a video feed and actually predict something cool? So if you see here, I have an image on which I am trying to predict, and it says that, okay, this is a melanoma I'm detecting, and you should go see a doctor. Okay.
So let me see if I understand what's going on. As you're doing this, because traditionally, like I'm used to cognitive services, I would send something to a REST API, and it would send back whether you should see a doctor or not, for example. In this case, the video is sending the pictures to a local thing on board, and so it doesn't even have to be connected to the internet.
Yes, for example, in my phone here, I don't even have internet working.
I see.
Okay, so internet is turned off. For example, if I just hold it on my hand, and I'm trying to... So if you see here, it's telling me I'm all clear. Okay, it's telling me I'm all clear. I do not need to worry about it. That's my own hand feed. I'm just feeding it. So it's all live feed. So what I'm doing is I'm just giving it all live feed in the phone. I have a trained model deployed and it's just processing in a real time and just giving me the information.
So for those that are new to machine learning, why don't you describe what a model is and how you can actually have it fit on a device or work in a device?
Yeah, for that let us go to my screen.
Awesome.
And see. As you can see my screen here, I have the Azure Machine Learning up and running. You can run it anywhere, but because it's Azure makes your training processes easier, I'm running my model in Azure Machine Learning. Here, as you can see, I have my training code. Here, I have developed, going a little bit deeper into the code, I am showing you here, I have a Keras model, which has got three layers, okay? I have two convolution layers, as you can see here, two 2D convolutions, and I have a max pooling index layer. Okay. So this is exactly what my model is, and I have trained it on a research data set. The data set is called the ISIC cancer data set. So it's an open data set. I've just taken that data set and trained my model on it. Okay.
I see. So just to be clear, this is the part of where you actually train the model.
Right.
And the data you got from a data set that has pictures of cancer right. pictures and non-cancer
yeah.
pictures?
Yeah. It's a labeled data set of melanoma. Mm-hmm. And it tells me, okay, this image is a carcinogenic image and this is a non-carcinogenic image. And it tells you, okay, whether you have a melanoma or not. So I have taken, this is a classification algorithm. So what I've done is I've taken the images, I've trained a Keras classification model on top of it in Azure, okay?
Okay, so as I'm looking at this, it's effectively, you're using a convolutional neural network
right,
with one
right.
layer. Well, right. one convolutional layer is a max pooling and dropout, and then,
right.
okay.
Yep.
And then you run this, I suspect, somewhere on right. this particular data. So tell
right.
us about that.
So what I do is I have actually trained my models. I have uploaded the data just in my local machine. I can upload it in Azure Blob Storage, wherever I want. And I have actually pre-processed data and created tensors. As you can see here, I have a training tensor, a validation tensor, and test tensor. It's a very very machine learning specific thing. What you do is you divide your data set into your training, test, and validation data set.
Okay.
First, you train on your training data set, then you do your validation on the training code, and then you bring in your test data set, something which the model has not seen at all.
I see.
Then you test it. So with that, let me go to the scoring and show you how that's doing.
Let's do that. So as you're going there, just to be clear, you train it on this bulk of data, but you got to know how well it's doing.
No.
So you got to use the validation data to see if everything's going according to plan, and then
right.
you use the stuff that it's never seen before and
right.
say, does this generalize well?
Right,
okay.
exactly. So what I'm doing here is basically I'm loading the model. What I'm saying here is, okay, take a test image, what you have not seen, and then run that test image, okay? And I'm saying, okay, to load your model, you load it from this schema.json. So I've trained my model, I've saved my model, schema, and my model weights. I'm loading it up, and what I'm doing is I'm actually giving it a test image, trying to test it.
Awesome, so this now we've shifted from the actual training to this is how you predict the thing.
Right,
got it.
Where
okay.
the whole prediction of the app is coming from, right? So here what you're saying is, my model is saying, okay, using TensorFlow backend for Keras, and it's giving me, if you can see, two flags, two numbers. If you see, the first flag is for the non-malignant.
Yeah.
The second flag is for the malignancy. If you see, the coding logic goes in this way. Whichever is bigger is the flag, the predicted flag. As you can see here, my malignancy flag is much higher than the non-malignant flag. So that's why the predicted label comes out to be malignant here.
I see, so if you're predicting between different kinds of melanoma, it might be a larger vector with, okay.
Right, this
Got
is
it.
A binary classification that we are doing. A classification of two types of
Got
things.
It.
Suppose I had lesions, moles, different types of dermatitis to be categorized, I would have a multi-label classification problem. That is, I have multiple labels for multiple different types
Got
of
it.
Problems, right?
And in this case, you would train a different model that would have multiple outputs, and you would give it different data for
it. Right. It just depends on how you're training your model, how you're defining your model. And the model that I'm using could be used for multi-level classification also. All you need to do is just change your number of labels and your label list, and it will work seamlessly
awesome.
for binary as well as for multi-level classification.
Fantastic. So when you're building this, and this is going to get to sort of the heart of what a data scientist is, because I understand machine learning models like from a mathematical perspective, but I've never like actually done anything as a data scientist. How did you know to use a convolutional neural network, and how did you know to set it up the way you did? Is there just like a trial and error?
It's mostly a trial and error process, especially if you're training your network from scratch.
Okay.
If I would have been using something called transfer learning, which is very common for image classification, I could have avoided a lot of complexity. But because healthcare images are very, very domain specific, you need to have those your hyperparameters adjusted correctly to make your model learn very well.
For example,
if you see here in the training code I'm opening, it's giving me an accuracy, training accuracy of almost 90%,
mm-hmm.
right? So that is a very high accuracy. If I would have been using transfer learning where I'm taking a pre-trained generic model, pre-trained on ImageNet or something like that, and I'm trying to modify it for the healthcare, it would have got me to around 80-85% at most.
And that makes sense, because the transfer learning has been trained on a generic set of images,
right.
and these images, like, they're generally not in the generic set.
Right, okay, right. It's very, very domain specific. It has different types of information, color information, edge information, dimension information embedded inside. So if you want to learn all of those, you need to create things from scratch. Hyperparameter optimization is the hardest thing when you're training a model from scratch. So I had to spend a lot of time while training on the hyperparameter optimization part.
Why don't you describe what a hyperparameter is? That way people that are looking, that maybe are new to data science, can understand.
So hyperparameters, for example, let's take the classification example, because hyperparameters can be huge, okay? But for classification models, hyperparameters are your learning rate, your initial learning rate, mm-hmm. your learning rate decay, that is, because you're doing convolution, you're just learning in the forward pass, and then you're decaying it when you're doing the backward pass, right? So there is learning rate, there's learning rate decay, and there is also something called the batch size. So you're trying to learn in batches. So you cannot just give all your data and your memory would be overflown, right? So you would need to identify, okay, what is your batch size? Another thing you need is the optimizer. That is actually defined for describing your loss. For me, I spent the most time on the optimization part of the loss. I have been using RMS prop, mm-hmm. But it was not converging my model. So I had to change to Atom optimizer and had to change the values of the Atom optimizer to make my model converge and come to a 90% accuracy.
I see. So the hyperparameters are sort of the extra values that you put, the secret ingredients into the actual model.
Yes, that's the secret sauce of the chef.
usually there's a lot of trial and error to do that.
It's a lot of trial and error. To train the model with Azure machine learning, it took me very less time. But to build the model, that is where I spent a week to bring my hyperparameters in tune with each other so that they are working in perfect sync.
That's awesome. So this makes perfect sense. The thing that maybe is a little bit more unclear to me is how do you take these models, and because I saw how you did the prediction or the inferencing in here with Python, but how do you actually take this model and put it onto a device that can do prediction at the edge?
Right, for that, let me show you a conversion code that we are doing. So here, as you see in the code, what we are trying to do, we developed a Keras model, okay? We are loading up the Keras model. What we have done is we have installed CoreML in Azure Machine Learning, and I'm trying to convert the Keras model to the CoreML format. So let me define a little bit what CoreML is. CoreML is basically Apple's package of compression. It actually helps you compress your model weights in a format with all the dependent informations so that you can run it on any device. So imagine something like pseudo apt-get, mm-hmm. right? So imagine you have a deep learning environment, your dependencies, your model, everything inside your workbench or your Azure machine learning or wherever in your local machine. And you want to bring all of them together, as well as you want to compress the weights a little bit, because when you train a machine learning model, it's huge, right? So you would want to compress it so that your phone processor can run it seamlessly.
Right.
So all of these steps are taken care of by CoreML. So all I needed to do was call the CoreML converter, and through this a few lines of code, like three or four lines of code, it was able to take all my Keras dependencies from my environment along with the model and compress it and create a whole package, CoreML package. So when it creates a CoreML package, it's basically the name dot ML model.
I see.
Right? So anything star dot ML model is basically you're getting a CoreML package.
And that makes sense because like when you're doing inferencing, you're not going to need to have anything having to do with the learning rate or the decay weight or whatever optimization. You don't need that at all. You just need all the numbers that are going to be multiplied together and then how they're going to be output.
Exactly. You're so right. So now once we have converted that, what we did, that's the main reason why we are using a Mac today, is we put that CoreML model into Xcode and compiled it. That produces a star.ml model C file. Okay, so that produced a compiled version of the CoreML. Now you can drop it on any application and run it. For us, we are using Xamarin. Mm-hmm. And let me show you the Xamarin
app. Let's do it.
So as you can see in my screen here, I have the Xamarin app uploaded. As you can see in the resources, I have dropped the skin cancer mlmodel.c file, the compiled one, which I have compiled using Xcode. Here, as you can see, after compilation, it has created different versions of it. When I first created the model, it was all just a model, just keras.hdf5 file. But when I have compiled it, it has created all these separate files so that my app can effectively read it.
Okay,
that is what CoreML does. It takes every dependency. So it takes, okay, what is the weights? What is the shape? What is the architecture of my model? What are the binary, what are the DLLs? What are my dependencies? So everything comes along with the model.
I see. So you should think of this as like importing an assembly or a jar file or some kind of package that you're going to call to do the inferencing.
Exactly. Okay, exactly. Cool. This is very, very developer friendly thing. And you can actually take any model, convert it to an ML, CoreML compiled version and run it on any app. Okay.
And so if you have a data scientist in-house that has made some amazing model, use Keras or TensorFlow or something else that's pretty standard, you can ask them, hey, can you export this to an ML model and then use it in your application?
Exactly. In fact, what we have been doing is we are a team of data scientists and developers. So when I produce a model and give it to my developer knows to go to the CoreML, just convert it and just drop it onto the app.
Yeah, because it's, again, just an assembly. Like you would. Like it's a PDF assembly. Library. Nobody knows how PDFs are written, but we know that if you call a library, it will make one. Same thing here, except it will detect whether or not someone may have skin cancer.
That's right.
Amazing.
Yes. Yes. So once you have that, you go to the viewcontroller.cs file, and there, as you can see, this is a sample app you can find in the GitHub, in the Microsoft GitHub.
We'll make sure to put links. Yeah, we'll put links.
Yes.
There.
Yes. So here, as you can see, I have just pointed it to the model file name, and going down below in the logic where you're actually doing the like the calling of the prediction function, you're saying, okay, if my class name is Beline, class name is basically the label of the predicted label that you are getting, then suggest that you're all clear. However, if the class name is malignant, as you were seeing on my Azure ML workbench, just it's suggesting to go see a doctor.
So that's it. I mean, I feel like a lot of times when we talk about machine learning, it's like this voodoo magic. And when we look at the app initially, it felt a little voodoo magic-ish. But now that we've gone through, we saw the model, it was a convolutional neural network built in Keras. A lot of time was spent on making sure the hyperparameters were okay. Once they were done, you did some inferencing in Python to make sure it was, you know, it was like your internal check. Then you export to ML model. The ML model then goes into a Xamarin app, and you're done.
Yep. That's as simple as that. In fact, the Xamarin app part is super easy, you know. And we will put links in there. You take the sample app, you just change 3 or 4 lines of code, and you have your own specific app running. So instead of like a skin cancer, if you want to do a fruit classification, you can very easily do that.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, the thing that I like about this is that, like, we often, and I spend a lot of time studying machine learning models, and when we're talking about optimizing weights, and she's like, item optimize, I'm like, oh, that's really cool, you know? How did you figure out your batch size? How did you know the learning weight was 0.1 instead of, that to me is exciting, but then actually seeing from beginning idea all the way into an application is pretty amazing too. And in a short amount of time, we've only been spending like, we're 15 minutes in probably.
Yep.
Awesome. So where can people go to find out more, or is there anything that I'm missing?
You are not missing anything. So we do have an Azure GitHub link and the whole project in the Azure docs. So we will give you the link below in the video.
Awesome. Well, this has been amazing. Thanks so much for spending some time with us. Thanks so much for watching. We've been learning about computing at the edge, and we saw an entire example that's pretty amazing in just a couple of minutes. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.